Here.
Marsha Bird Bigler.
Here.
Jenny Breckus.
Here.
Naomi Newark.
Here.
Vaughn Harton. Absent. Jeanne Herman. Ed Larson.
Here.
Gina Martini.
Here.
And Paul McKenzie.
Here.
Okay, thank you. Salute to the flag. Mayor Martini, can you lead us in the pledge?
Please join me in the pledge of flag. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I would like to see approval of the agenda. Do I have a motion to approve the agenda?
Second.
Okay, I have a motion by Member Martini, second by Mayor Jardine. All those in favor? Aye. Opposed? Okay, motion carries. Let the record show that Governing Board Member Hartung is in attendance. And before we go to public comment, I just wanted to briefly, for those of you who are here and for those of us up on the dais also, this meeting, a special meeting, was called for the purpose of information sharing, basically to get information on the lands bill and what Washoe County, the good work that they have been doing in this possible process that we hope to be happening through our delegation in Washington. And so the purpose is for us to get information. I would like to, in the interest of time, because all of our time is valuable here today, I'd like to see if we could have a effective meeting that moves quickly, that we all have the opportunity to hear the information, and then questions or comments. What I'd like to do is, after the business of the day, when the presentation is made, I would like to wait and have a time period, maybe right now, allocate 20 minutes, and then we'll see if that's enough, for questions and comments. So if the board members could hold comments and questions and let us hear the whole presentation, and then we can have Mr. Whitney or others that can answer those questions up, would greatly appreciate that. So moving on, let's go ahead to public comment, item number 4. And I have Kathy Brandhurst.
My name is Kathy Brandhorst, and I'm also the United States President. I just wanted to tell you, you know, putting bugs into somebody's room and make sure that they are dead with black bugs all over their bodies, their faces, their mouths. And I don't know where you got this mattress from, but it could be Crossroads because they still have no running water and they still have no sewers. They still have no gas and electric. So the bed bugs are growing in this area. I wanted to tell you, you know, even though you do murder people with these bugs, I've been experiencing them biting me and leaving my blood spots all over my sheets. These bugs are desperate, you know, because I guess you teach them how to bite into a human and make sure they can suck out the blood. But I just wanted to tell you too, you know, with other things that have been going on in the motel, like carrying machine guns inside the room and make sure that they're going to die because they are U.S. military, They are dismantlers, and you don't want them here in our area, our territory. Well, that's why they're here. They're trying to help us here to bring justice for us so we could be free in the United States. We are not free with you being here in our area. We still complain that you put many bullets in our bodies in order to, for you to say that we are going to bury you in the cemetery. And I've been noticing you're all out there in the cemetery digging them up, you know, so that you could have your body parts, also your organs, the blood, and the skin especially. Oh, and lots and lots of chopped heads. I'm experiencing so many chopped heads off of these bodies, and they are with the U.S. military and dismantlers. They are getting tired of it.
Thank you. Okay, our next public comment would be Ed Lawson.
Good afternoon. Ed Lawson for the record, Sparks City Council. And this is for information purposes for the board. And since I was so late in getting it to you, our attorney advised I should give this talk under public comment. So let's go ahead and get right into it.
Ed, do you need, as representing the City of Sparks, do you need a extended, if you're doing a PowerPoint, do you need 5 minutes instead of three?
Could, if you wouldn't mind.
Five or six.
I think I can get through and faster, but... Okay. If I need the extra couple of minutes, would be great.
Madam Chair,
do I have a motion? Do I have a motion that we accept a longer presentation? Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, so this is kind of the, as Gino said, this was my big nightmare. I woke up and how are we going to absorb all these 50,000 jobs that are coming our way? And if you've looked at EDON, we're right on track to have those 50,000 jobs in our area by 2020. Our current tax structure does not work as far as building homes alone is a dead loser in the long run because of the way of our taxes, the way it works. So what we're looking at is there's about 35,000 acres, and you're going to see maps here in a minute, that is east of Sparks, and it kind of works its way down to towards the river and going to Story County. And we're working with the congressional delegation along with Washoe County. This is a compliment to the Washoe County. This is not something Sparks is doing on its own. This is just something for me to explain to the business community what's going on as far as in Sparks, okay? The proximity of Story County, actually have had conversations with Story County. They're very interested in helping us with an I-80 exchange to link the property, Washoe County and Story County together. We would be a complement to the TRIC Center, doing 25 to 500 acres. They're doing 500 acres and above. And those are slopes. These are hard to see, and we'll send this to you guys if you want. All the pink is the 30% and greater slopes. If you notice kind of there in the middle top portion is very flat up there, and towards the lower portion is very flat down there. So there's a lot of developable area. And then this is all the BLM land. This, and you'll hear more, Bill tell us that, about this more, but you see it goes right down to Story County, right down to the, actually comes out very near where the Apple storage is. And we put a proposed road in there because we think that the future with 50,000 jobs in Story County, they're going to have to get home. They're going to live with us. I think the majority of them are going to live with us. They're going to have to get home. So if they want to get to Sparks or the North Valleys or even, you know, as far over into the other valleys, this road makes a lot of sense. Next. And I forgot what that one says. Oh, that's the slopes again. Next. And then this, if you notice, Maybe I have another map. This is another proposed road. I'm proposing two roads to come into Sparks. One that would come out in the DeAndrea Copper Canyon area, and one that would come out further north into Spanish Springs next. And this is to put it all in scale. That big yellow box is the tri-storage, the trick properties. If you overlaid that on Reno and Sparks, they're nearly the same size as us geographically. They're going to have a huge impact on us, and I think that's the last one. Yep. So just my way of thinking about this. I've had some conversations. EDON's behind this. The governor's office is behind this for us all also, and Bill's going to probably tell you all the same things. But Story County is behind it, and that's a big deal. Obviously, Story County is getting the bulk of the revenue. We're going to get the bulk of the expenses in Washoe County. So we really need to consider ways to offset that. And I think the Sparks Industrial Center, or whatever we want to call it, we just had to name it something, is a good first step in that direction. And that is my presentation. I did it in 4 minutes.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. We're going to go ahead and move on the agenda. We're on item 5, business of the day. Item 5A for possible action, presentation, discussion, and possible action on the Washoe County Economic Development and Conservation Act. And we have a presentation by Bill Whitney with Washoe County. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Madam Chair. For the record, Bill Whitney, Washoe County Planning and Development Director. So I tried to fit this onto a PowerPoint like we usually do, but the two maps that I passed out to you just do not project well on a PowerPoint. So you should have in front of you, all of you, two things. A printout that is titled Economic Development and Conservation Act, and then the two maps that I'm going to talk about. And the printout is on our website, Washoe County's website. There's a place on our homepage where you can link to a information page on the Economic Development and Conservation Act. And that's exactly what I printed out and gave to you. And we'll just go through that briefly so that I can give you an understanding of kind of the big picture of the public lands bill that we've been working on. And then the two maps that I passed out to you, I know still in front of you, that's a small scale. So I can project them up on the big screens. And when I talk about those, that's what I'll do in a minute. Basically wanted to orient you about the overall picture here of what we've been working on in this federal lands bill, and then give you a description of the different maps. So you can see there that on that first page on the handout, we start with a thing that's called open house. That's new, and that's been planned as the start of our stakeholder outreach and our citizen outreach. We just set these up recently, so that's new information. We're going to have start off with two open houses, one on September 16th from 1 to 3 here, and then one on September 19th from 4 to 6:30 here also. So the second component on that front page are the two maps. And I thought I'd start with the disposal boundary map and give you a description of that. If you could please put that one on the overhead. So I'll use so the red line shows up pretty well on this. Now, that's Southern Washoe County, and the red line around a lot of that area is what we're calling the disposal boundary. And what you also see on there is the bright green. That's U.S. Forest Service managed lands. And then the majority of the public lands are the brown, and that's Bureau of Land Management managed lands. So the concept is that all the federal lands within that boundary can be potentially disposed of in the future for economic purposes, public facilities, conservation, trails and recreation. And that's what, in the handout here, we like to refer to as a local government control boundary or disposal boundary. They're referred to as both. And so just real briefly, where this boundary is, and I think it might be easiest to look at your maps. Down there in the south, the very south, you'll see the boundary going east-west, right below the Mount Rose Highway. And it does not include at this time, this is all draft. I meant to start out my presentation with this is draft proposal. That goes east-west down there at the southern part, right below south of the Mount Rose Highway, does not include that large block of Bureau of Land Management land on the east side of Washoe Valley that would be between Washoe Valley and Story County. That was acquired not that long ago by the Bureau of Land Management. That was a checkerboard pattern. They acquired that at the urging of Washoe County and a bunch of other groups to block that up for wildlife recreation, wildlife and recreation and watershed protection. So the boundary starts above that, goes west over to the bright green boundary of the Forest Service, and then heads straight north up the edge of that big block of bright green Forest Service. What's hard to see there before it heads north is that there's all kinds of small Forest Service parcels starting at 2.5 acre, most of them are 5 acre, and then there's some bigger ones that are right off the Mount Rose Highway that are included within the boundary, the disposal boundary. And those are basically along Whites and Thomas Creek in that area, and some in the hills above Galena High School. So there's not a lot of Forest Service property included within the boundary, for a lot of different reasons, but that is where there are quite a few different smaller parcels included. So the boundary goes north along the Forest Service, and then it hits McCarran Boulevard and follows McCarran through the developed areas, and then catches on again on Peavine on the Forest Service property and goes up the edge of the Forest Service property along there and hits 395, and then it follows 395 south out towards Cold Springs, and then heads north again right between Red Rock Road and Cold Springs. You'll see the red line going north. One of the options was to take that all the way to the California border and then follow the border up. The decision was made, again, this is draft, to go north in those hills there between Red Rock and Cold Springs and leave the stuff along the California border out, because if you go a little further north, that's the Peterson Mountains. And it's not a wilderness area, but it's a special designation. So anyhow, that it didn't go to the border. It goes north and jogs up by Red Rock and then continues further north to its furthest northern point, which is by Rancho Haven. And then it heads east along a section line, a township line, I'm sorry. Better look at my own map. Heads east on Township 24 and 23's line, and then goes over to the Pyramid Reservation. That's that kind of limish green color. That's the reservation boundary. Follows that and then starts heading south down around along the Pahra range. Comes down to a point and then goes back over to the reservation boundaries. Comes down to I-80 and the Truckee River and follows the Truckee River all the way back through the I-80 corridor back into Vista there at Sparks. And then follows the Washoe Story County line south to where we started. So that's the boundary. I just wanted to give you a little explanation of where it is right now. And you can see what's in it. The second map is the land transfer requests. So part of this draft bill, the federal legislation, is the ability for local jurisdictions like Reno, Sparks, Washoe County, and other local government and quasi-government entities to request transfer of federal lands to them from the federal government. And that's what this map shows. And that would be that darker flesh-colored, hatched flesh-colored on your map. It's even darker on the screen up here. And those are all the parcels that I've received so far and requests for transfers. And I wanted to point out a couple that immediately catch people's eyes. I've had a lot of questions about them. And that would be the large one at the down by Verdi there in the Forest Service property. And then the large, very large one to the in the farthest north on that map, that's about a 6,000 acre parcel at the very northern edge. Both of those are requested by Truckee Meadows Water Authority, but they haven't done, they don't have the refined data to me yet as to really how much they need. So it's parcel based right now, and those are just two big parcels. That one down by I-80 in Verdi, there's a water tank that is on Forest Service property that Tumwa owns. They own the water tank, and it's on Forest Service property. They would like to own the land under that water tank, but it's one big parcel. And so that is just an explanation as to why some of these are, those two in particular, are so darn large. They don't need the whole parcel, but they, right now it's just parcel based. And that one up north, that big one up there, it's about a 6,000 acre parcel. Tumwa also is looking at that for water infiltration basins and some other facilities that they see they might need in the future. They don't need the whole parcel, but right at the moment it's showing it as the whole parcel. What else you see on this map is right there in the center, the big square between Pyramid Highway and Lemon Valley. That is Reno Sparks, part of that is Reno Sparks Indian Colony's request to expand their colony up there in Hungry Valley. And also you see over along the Pyramid Reservation in about quite a few places right on the edge of the reservation, that's the Pyramids tribe request to expand their reservation. Now, they've been working on these for quite a while in different forms, and we told them, we the county told them a long time ago, the county commissioner said, we will include your requests if we ever get a lands bill going. And so we're living up to that promise. They also have their own bill back in Washington that I understand is fairly close to passing. It's called the Native Nations Act, but I just wanted to point those out and why those were on there. And then there's a lot of different miscellaneous parcels for lots of different reasons. I listed down there by the county logo in the bottom right-hand corner. There's a box that shows a lot of the different agencies that are requesting transfers of different parcels. At this scale, I can't number each parcel and show which agency wants each one, but we've got that data in our GIS system. So I think that gives you a good overview of the two main maps that are part of this draft legislation. And moving on, component number, let's see, this would be on your second page of your typed handout. That says component number two. So a large component of a federal lands bill, whether it's ours or pretty much any other county in the state of Nevada that's done one, is a balance between this economic development factor and local jurisdiction requests and wilderness. And that's, you'll see that in almost all the other, I think maybe all the other county lands bills that have happened. And the wilderness proponents have been working very hard on the wilderness study areas and other areas in northern Washoe County that they feel are appropriate to become wilderness. And that's the other component to this lands bill. And I can touch on some general concepts around that. We do have a link on this page to Friends of Nevada Wilderness, their website. They've got some great descriptions of the areas they would like to see become wilderness. They've got maps, they've got acreages, and they've got descriptions and some photographs. So that's the good source there. Sharon Netherden is here from Friends of Nevada Wilderness if you have questions later about that wilderness component. So again, on that same page, moving down, component number three is the bill itself, the draft of the legislation itself. That draft is still with our congressional people back in Washington. They're the ones that are putting that together. I've been, myself and some other people at the county have been working with them on that. It's in their hands right now. They say it's not ready to release. I'm anxious to have it released and get it on our website. But what we've got here in these different bullets are components of what you'll see in the county lands bill along with the other county's lands bills throughout the state that have happened. They're all not identical, but they're all basically a lot alike. So bullet number one, federal government shall coordinate land sales with a unit of local government in whose jurisdiction the lands are located, and land sales shall be consistent with local government master planning and regulatory zone requirements. And that one and the second bullet kind of go hand in hand, and in my opinion, that's very, very important. That's where we come to that that term local government control boundary. The third bullet, the sale of any federal lands within the federal lands disposal boundary shall be through a competitive bidding process and for not less than fair market value. So again, governments and other local jurisdictions can request transfers to get that federal land for public purposes, but the rest of that land, if it's going to be auctioned off for economic development, it will be through an auction process to the highest bidder. That's the way it's been done in Clark County for a lot of years, and we're following that same mold. Then the fourth bullet, the exchange of any federal lands within the boundary will be for other lands that the BLM or the Forest Service have included in a management priority area on a value for value exchange basis. So exchanges, there's auction of the land, potential auction, and then there's potential exchanges. So if this bill passes, it will direct the BLM and the Forest Service to come up with a list, a wish list, of what some lands they would like to acquire in the local area, like an inholding in the Forest Service up in the Mount Rose Wilderness would be an example. They'll have that list. A individual could come to them and say, I'll exchange this land for that land and on a value for value basis. So that's the other possibility of how that land could be disposed of. And then that last bullet on that page, the disposition of the proceeds from the sale of federal lands will be specifically spelled out in the legislation, the majority of the proceeds being used by the federal, and flip the page, used by the federal government. And these are pretty important items here for sage grouse habitat conservation and restoration projects to address drought in Washoe County, wildfire pre-suppression and restoration activities in the county, acquisition of environmentally sensitive lands in the county, and Lake Tahoe restoration projects, and reimbursement of costs to the federal government or those agencies involved with the implementing of this bill. So I'm going to learn more about that with some meetings I've got with the BLM and the Forest Service coming up, but they do have costs associated with disposal of land. You can imagine it's the federal government, and they have quite a few things they have to do that take time and money. So That's the bulk of the proceeds from the auction of the lands within that boundary would go to the federal government for those purposes. The next bullet says the smaller amount of the proceeds from the sale of federal lands are proposed to be divided among the state of Nevada and Washoe County for educational purposes, and then a separate account going to the county for general budgeting purposes. I believe the quite a few of the counties in the state, it's typically an 85-15 split on the proceeds. We already talked about the 85% for the federal government. And the 15% to the local jurisdictions can be a little bit different in different bills. I believe the proceeds being split between the state of Nevada and the Washoe County for educational purposes is, I don't know if it's unique to Washoe County, but splitting between the state and the county is different than some of the other land bills. And then a separate amount going to the county for general budgeting purposes. So when we dispose of these lands and they're developed and there's regional impacts, those kind of those monies in our general budget would go to address regional kind of expenses like expanding the jail and the courthouse and that kind of thing. So then that last bullet, details on the wilderness portion of the lands bill will include specifics on how these areas are to be managed by the BLM, including any existing uses that are still allowed and the release of wilderness study areas that have been determined to not be wilderness. And I don't know, I don't think I should take the time here today to explain the whole wilderness study area concept, and but I'd be happy to talk to you afterwards. Most of the wilderness, in a nutshell, most of the wilderness in northern Washoe County that's being proposed in this bill comes from wilderness study areas. And those are 20-plus-year-old designations that were made on areas throughout the state, and quite a few in northern Washoe County, that had wilderness qualities, but nobody ever took any kind of action to make them wilderness. So they were in this limbo for the last 20-plus years. Are they, you know, they're being managed as wilderness by the Bureau of Land Management of the Forest Service, but they're not really wilderness. So if you go to the Wilderness, Friends of Nevada Wilderness website, I think you can learn more about that, or you can always ask me after the meeting, or Sharon Netherden. She's still here, Sharon? There she is. So I think that's the overview that I wanted to get to you so that you can understand kind of the big picture of what's going on here. And like I said, we've got some public workshops starting up in September. At the last page that I of your typed handout, I have a stakeholder list. It's pretty big, but I would love it if you had a chance to look at it, and if you see somebody that you think's important that's missing, just, you know, write it on there and pull this page off and give it back to me, or just tell me after the meeting. I want to make sure I don't miss somebody or some group that's important. Councilwoman Dewar gave me already a name of a minerals group that I didn't have on there, so thanks for that. Okay, that's it for me, and I'm available to answer questions.
Thank you so much for your presentation. I will open it to either comments, or specifically I'd like questions, and maybe we should ask John Slaughter and Kevin Schiller maybe to come up if there's any questions you think you could. Do you want to wait and see if there's a question that I'll let Bill decide who else he wants to call up, and or if it's a wilderness one, we'll let you call someone else up to answer a question. Questions from the dais?
Presentation. No one has a question.
I'll come up
Couldn't
with one.
Couldn't have been that good.
I hadn't pre-thought this, but Madam?
Member Dewar.
In terms of disposal, since that's what we've got the maps on here, what have we thought about a process, or I know it says, it says that it would be described in the bill, I think, or at least the funding, where the funds will go. But what kind of process do we envision? Let's say Tamwa, since you mentioned him, wants this a portion of the 6,000 acre for reinjection or infiltration. Mm-hmm. What are you thinking for a process? How would they go about acquiring that?
I believe your question is what? How would that actually happen? Transfer from the federal government to Tamwa?
Yeah, let's just say the red line is adopted. It's within the red line. In this case, maybe they don't need that whole 6,000 acres, as you mentioned, but maybe they need a couple thousand. How would it work?
I don't have the specifics on that yet, but generally, Tamwa would give their mapping, you know, some detailed data of what they want, and give it to us. We would work with the BLM to transfer that land. The BLM would do the majority of that work, and if it's federal land, so they have to look at any kind of considerations that they're required to look at and do their due diligence. And then I don't have the specifics yet on title transfer.
Well, let me just give you a different example then. Let's say it's Tamwa and they only need a portion of this 6,000 acres. And let's say a developer is also interested in a portion of the 6,000 acres. I mean, would there be some kind of noticing to where you said it would go to a bid process, but would Tamwa or an agency have to be bidding against a private developer? I don't know how this has worked elsewhere.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I think I understand your question better now. So there's two maps. The land transfer map that the different agencies have said, we want this parcel for this. That's their ask. You know, that's what they're asking to get transferred from the federal government to them. They would not have to bid on it. They would not have to deal with it in the open market. That is a separate function than the lands within the boundary. Even though that what they want might be in the boundary, it's something they're asking for specifically, a piece of land.
So would you call it, like they called it first, and they would ask for all or a portion of this? And I guess what I'm wondering is, what if a developer came in before Tamwa was ready, you know, or maybe Tamwa said, you know, we've remapped the basins and it's really this BLM area to the south we're interested in for the filtration. You know, would government agencies get a first kind of shot at this, or what are you thinking?
Yes. The answer is yes. So the transfer lands that are on that map, aside, if a piece of land within the disposal boundary is auctioned off, local government and local agencies will get their input first on that land before it goes to the person, the highest bidder. So RTC says we need a road, a right-of-way for a road through that property. So they would get that input. Reno says, you know, they need a water tank in this area, and or Tamwa or somebody like that. So they get first shot at that.
Are you basically saying that let's say in this exact same case, developer came in and they were interested in the area near a road, and do you think that the agencies would screen that first, like go through a review process of some kind?
Absolutely.
The government agencies before, and it might come up that RTC needed a road area there, you know, mm-hmm. but you didn't know about it, because now it's 5 years from now, let's say.
That's a good example, because RTC has sent me two road alignments that they're looking at into the future that are in the BLM land north or in the vicinity of where Mr. Lawson was showing his maps. So that's hard to show as a transfer, but there is that ability for somebody like RTC or any other local entity to say, we need this for a public purpose.
Okay. But it might be driven by another person's ask, maybe. It might not have floated up at that point in time ready to go.
If they're ready, yeah. I would hope that when whatever local government or entity is ready, they'll plug that in and give us that data.
Thank you.
Other comments or questions? Ms. Breckus?
Thank you. So at our last TMRPA board meeting, my colleague to the right mentioned that there's been a plan for a long time to have this disposal bill. And I remember about 10 years ago, it did come up. Is it, is the policy basis for this bill anywhere in any county adopted documents? I don't think it's in the regional plan, although I could be incorrect, but is it in your master plan or any other documents that you have adopted at the county level?
Nope, it is not. We didn't contemplate this kind of thing when we did our master plan. And it's not in the regional plan. These kind of things, as they happen per county around the state, are a separate federal, you know, action.
Just seems like a good idea. I guess I'm trying to understand, and I've seen the resolutions, I'm trying to understand, and I think it would be helpful if there's a regional policy basis for this. And some of the things I'm hearing are, you know, it's so that we can get this, you know, action at the federal level for wilderness areas. Do we have some general land use needs? When I see some of these bills, it's, you know, the first shot is almost for recreation and open space. Does the county have a recreation or open space that identifies lands for acquisition or to you know, provide recreational opportunities that maybe some of these parcels are? Do you go down to that level in another document?
Yes, we do. Part of our county master plan is the regional open space plan. And it's an adopted section of our master plan, and it addresses all kinds of different resources. And so that is part of the review that that is looked at.
Okay. So we could, and that's kind of another question, is I'm trying to understand the policy basis. If it's specific parcels for specific purposes, you mentioned Tumwa wanting one and you know, the recreation. So do you have like a side table that you could give us with an APN and who the requesting agency was and the purpose so that we can, and the public could vet this a little bit more?
Yes, that data is in our GIS system.
Okay.
I was hoping to get it refined before I handed that out because, like I pointed out on that map, there's a 6,000-acre parcel, and Tumwa doesn't need all of that for infiltration basins.
Sure, that would be helpful. I guess another thing, then, to take it to the next level, should this move forward on a parcel-by-parcel basis, we're doing a lot of work at the city of Reno. Actually, just the last couple of weeks, we've been producing, having some data come out, and I know we're kind of working in tandem with the regional plan, but for example, our employment demand and needs analysis that just came out this week is showing that logistics and distribution is paying about average $29,000 a year. That's less than our median income. So I guess if we get looking at parcels and we're saying, hey, this is for distribution and warehouse, and I don't know if that use would be identified at time of release, well, that would be helpful, so then we can back out what sort of economic, because we're calling this economic development. And so if it's economic development that's going to produce jobs less than the median, it raises the question from, I think, our perspective, is that the best place to put our Tumwa resources, our RTC resources, you know, our fire response? Do you envision that level of detail going in on a parcel-by-parcel basis as lands are proposed for release?
Excuse me, in the draft legislation that we're working on now, no. It's a boundary around an area around the greater Truckee Meadows where this federal land could be disposed of for various reasons, or that other map. So when you get down the road and you get to that point where you're going to auction off some land, then those land use master plan, zoning, local jurisdictional rules come into play. And I think that's where our planning, our local planning and our regional planning, that's where the rubber hits the road for that, is when it actually, sometime in the future, when that land is getting ready to be auctioned off.
Okay, so for example, these two RTC alignments, you know, so it's, I don't know, $200 million for these RTC, even though you can reserve the right-of-way, Reno knows it's a commitment of regional resources for a $200 million road and can equate that to the transportation deficiencies that we have in Southwest Reno that hasn't received any RTC fuel index money over the 10-year lifespan. So we can really do cost and benefit analysis even before we put them out on the auction block, you think?
Well, using the RTC as an example, those two alignments are, I believe they're in their 2035 plan. So it's not something that they just kind of said, whoa, we might need a road there in the future. So they're plugging this, or this is coming from their master planning also. So I would envision that as this land, this federal land is released and auctioned off, that then, well, I'm not envisioning, it'll say that in the bill, that this land, this new federal land that's now private, is subject to local master planning and local zoning. And, you know, that'll be in the bill. So okay. That's certain.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Bill, I have a question kind of following up on that. So really what we're looking at with the first map is the first step in probably a very long process, since we're working with the federal government. I don't expect anything to be done quickly. But really the first one is the boundary for possible disposal. It's starting that, starting the process of asking for federal disposal of these lands. The second map shows some of the parcels and requests that are coming from Tama, from the wilderness group, from from the tribes, for various specific requests they already have with the federal government. But as far as everything that Member Breckus is talking about and what we're looking at that would affect us here at regional planning, is way down the road because that will happen as far as our planning and the land use and what's appropriate for those, other than these specific requests that outside groups have already put in their ask. The rest of it would be just released and then follow the steps within the local jurisdictions for zoning, for master planning. I mean, am I on track? Is that what we're doing?
Yes, you're on track, exactly. And I'd like to point out that there are some requests from Incline Village General Improvement District in the Tahoe Basin to acquire some Forest Service property that surrounds their ski area, Diamond Peak, where they have some facilities on Forest Service. So we have actually two regional authorities involved, this one and Tahoe Regional Planning Agency. I know that we at the county deal with them, but there's both of them.
And it's actually part of what's going on statewide. So the land bill, county-wise in the state, every county is doing the same process or looking for lands, whether it's mining in one county, whether it's Southern Nevada, the rurals have the opportunity in trying to get federal land released for whatever purposes those counties deem necessary.
Yeah, it's a county-by-county bill. That is federal legislation, and there's usually some unique thing in each county that is kind of driving this. It all started down in Southern Nevada 20-something years ago with the Southern Nevada Public Lands Management Act, because North Las Vegas and Las Vegas had completely grown up to BLM boundaries. They were hemmed in, and that's when our Washington delegation got involved and came up with this idea.
Let me get questions or comments, Mr. Hartung.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I think it's important to add this in. My colleague to the left had a question with respect to how this was talked about and instituted. This was originally talked about at the Nevada Lands Transfer Task Force, which was a member from all of the 17 counties across the state, and that's where the original conversation, that's where it came from as far as our conversation. And I know that many years before that it was being talked about. The idea at that point was to transfer either all of the lands in Nevada or pieces of land in Nevada. That's what the task force was charged to look at. And many of us said we don't want all of the lands for our county, but we would like to have a process by which we could identify lands for economic development or public use and have them moved into the disposal or onto the disposal list easily, much like SNPLMA. So that's where the conversation started. With respect to RTC, I think that many of those roads where new development would occur would come through a CCFEA process, whereby the developer would have to pay to mitigate their impact either through RIF fees or some other process, a CCFEA process. So I don't think that we're going to be on the hook, and I think it's important to also remember industrial and commercial lands, which is much of what we're talking about, require far less services with police, with fire, with water. All of the services that are required are greatly reduced. So this is nothing more than a process. We've been asked to put a boundary around it. It's just a process. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay. Let me see someone who hasn't asked any comments or questions so that everybody gets a chance. No one down there? No. Okay. Ms. Stewart?
Yeah, sure. This could be controversial. I hope not. But in terms of the disposal, it's to various federal projects such as sage grouse. There's a fire, drought. I would like to recommend that the federal government's been very short on being able to provide funding for the flood project, which affects all Washoe County along the river, and that potentially be included in the list. Flood management seems a lot like drought management, wildfire, etc., and also environmental sensitive lands. You know, they're all kind of related, natural resource issues. So it's just an idea. I'm not on that board, but, you know, it's something to consider. Maybe you could forward that. The second question I was looking, trying to peer closely, and there these tract lands that are down along Mount Rose. So some of those are in my ward, and it's right where the city of Reno meets the Washoe County. And I wonder, do you think, I mean, I don't have any experience in this, do you think that all the tract lands would be done at one time, or it would be an individual coming in to ask for a specific tract? It's on page 2 of your list here. I mean, they're very tiny. I gave you the giant example of the 6,000 acre. Now I'm looking at the tiny, tinies. And I don't know if they already have, since they're Forest Service land, if there's already some kind of inholding. But I don't think they'd be green if there were. So what do you think about those?
Well, maybe a little bit more explanation about why some of those are on here. There's a 90-acre parcel right on Arrow Creek Parkway that the Forest Service owns. It's right next to Huntsberger.
Right.
Yeah. And prime land for residential development, surrounded by residential development. The Forest Service really doesn't want to own that. They don't know what to do with it.
Right.
Now, that's on the transfer list. The school district is looking at that as a possible, I believe, middle school site. But they don't need all 90
all that,
acres.
Yeah.
So there's this flexibility then that the rest could go for residential development potentially.
Okay.
A lot of those smaller pieces you're seeing are on White's Creek or Thomas Creek.
Right.
The county, under our open space plan, has requested transfer of those to protect the watershed, the riparian, and for the trails along those two creeks.
Makes a lot of sense. I used to live right over there near Thomas Creek. So that makes a lot of sense to me. I didn't know if we were suddenly going to free up land for development right on White's Creek and Thomas Creek, or what the plan was there.
No.
No. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Member Herman?
How will this project or this ordinance or whatever we want to call it affect the rights of the ranchers and the miners in that area? Because there are some with allotments in those areas.
Well, you know, Commissioner Herman, you might know better if there's allotments within that boundary than I do. I remember from quite a few years ago that there were still grazing allotments. And I don't have a good answer for that. Now, what's been worked on extensively by the wilderness proponents is further north, where areas would, you know, be transferred to wilderness, and how folks with allotments up there or mining claims or that kind of thing would be affected. And they've been working closely with the ranchers in the northern part under the wilderness component. Here, if there's still some allotments up, you know, north of Red Rock or something like that, I will ask the BLM how that would how that would play out. I don't know the answer to that right now.
Actually, we have some allotments right west of Palomino Valley, between there and Red Rock, so.
I'll find out from the BLM.
Okay, thank you.
And I think also what will be beneficial for any of us that want to attend or encourage people we know, not only on this stakeholder list, but in the public, to attend the two open houses with an opportunity to ask more questions to sometimes in a bigger, you know, with a large group of just citizens that have other concerns, being able to hear them getting the information and getting citizen input, I think is really important and something that would benefit us as well if we wanted to attend those. I think we're past our 20 minutes that I had hoped for discussion. Do I have any other questions or comments?
I'd like to make a last comment.
Ms. Stewart?
Yeah, I know Sharon Netherton's out here, and I just wanted to do a shout-out to her. I did spend the better part of a whole day with her recently with some folks, and she was very, you know, willing to work, spend a lot of time, and made some changes, as I understand, into the wilderness area. So I think that's a very good and collaborative process. I just want to give her a shout-out. And I wanted to give you also, Madam Chair, a shout-out for even being willing to schedule this. You know, I know we had a bit of a challenge last time discussion, but I think it's very worthwhile for us all to get a common understanding. So thank you.
Thank you. Hearing no other comments from the board, let's go to a public comment on item 5A, Kathy Brandhorst.
My name is Kathy Brandhorst, and I'm also the United States President. I've been getting so many complaints, it's just terrible. I'm getting a headache. Death Row has no place to live. They are at crossroads. Crossroads is a place, you know, for people who could not afford to pay rent. They still have this problem that they are paying for lawsuits. And the rent that was paid for at Crossroads, that is still paying for lawsuits. And that's still not enough money for them to cover for their lawsuits at all. And I just wanted to tell you that Death Row is all homeless out there at Crossroads. And stakeholders is what they are. They are planning to take out all those houses in that area because those neighbors are complaining that those poles and wires are connected to their houses. They can't really afford to pay for other people's problems at Crossroads, like gas, electric, even the problem is still existing with sewer lines. They're connected to their sewer lines. How many more people are going to be connected to their sewer lines? And, you know, it costs them money, but Crossroads wants to attach their problem to the other houses, the businesses that are on that property, and that's why the poles and wires are all connected to those houses and businesses. And so stealing houses again. You're planning to remove all of it so they'll stop complaining. Well, you can't do that because where are they going to go? They're going homeless with children. You know, the problem is still going to exist because you're going to put more poles and wires someplace else in order for you to have gas, electric, running water. Also, your sewer lines are going to be connected to wherever you move to. And that's not going to work either because we're going to get more complaints again. Crossroads is here and our property, and now they're stealing the gas and electric from us, and now they're going to be stealing the sewer lines and the water.
Okay, before I close out item 5A, there is a possible motion. Do I hear anyone on the dais would like to make a recommend a motion that's
motion to
packet?
Adjourn?
That wasn't an option.
It's always an option, Madam
So
Chair.
It's always an option.
You mean to accept the report or to, well,
there's some language in here.
Right, there's some, basically to follow the progress, directing Truckee Meadows Regional Planning Agency staff to follow the progress of this bill draft and provide periodic updates.
Madam
it's not an action for this committee other than asking them to follow it and keep us updated. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Okay,
second.
So moved. I have a motion by Ms. Dewar, second by Ms. Dardun. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
Two nays.
Three nays.
Three nays. Okay. Are we good? Motion still carries, correct? With three nays. I'm good. Okay, let's move on to item six on the agenda, 6A. Members and directors reports. Ms. Robinson?
Madam Chair, I have none.
Okay, do I have any members' reports? Okay, hearing none, we'll go on to item 6B. Mr. Acevedo, legal counsel report.
Madam Chair, I have nothing further.
Okay, hearing none, we'll move on to item 7 is requests for future agenda items. Do I have any requests for future agenda items? Hearing none, we'll move on to number 8, public comment. Kathy Brandhorst.
My name is Kathy Brandhorst, and I'm also the United States President. You know, that area where these small houses are owned individually, and they are run by, what are they? I guess parents and children. And they have a right to be there. They pay their bills, and they pay, you know, for the property taxes and whatever else that they have to pay for. That costs money. That, you know, that's for them to be responsible for, but they're not going to be responsible for any poles and wires connected to their houses. They live there. Give them a chance. Also, I just wanted to tell you, you know, the problem is still existing at the Donner. They have no place to live, so they're breaking into rooms over there. They said they're coming out of Crossroads, but they have no money. And how could they live at Donner when they have no money? They have to push people out of their homes, out of there. They also kill and murder people who already live there. And that's not fair because that's all the money we have. We cannot move. You tell us to move out, oh, we'll just throw you out in the street, and now you'll be, now we'll be able to move in. That's not the way to do it. There are so many complaints, you know. I just don't understand why you just can't get rid of Crossroads. Because they don't have a place to live, and they're going to continue to murder people inside their homes, and they live there. Give them a chance to the people who already live in their homes, give them the chance to live. Don't give Crossroads any more promises either because they can't afford it. They have the lawsuits, and those lawsuits keep growing because they're never going to stop. They're bank robbers, they are murderers, criminals, and that's why they have so many lawsuits to pay for. They are going to continue to do this. And I hope you're not putting people on that property there that do pay rent, because they will never have a chance at all. They will die on that property. They will be murdered. And then what will we find? More dead bodies. I just wanted to tell you that there's just no chance.
Thank you, Ms. Brandhorst. Okay, moving on to item 9. Ms. Robinson, do we have any written correspondence?
We do not.
Okay, moving on. Item 10, do I have a motion to adjourn? I have a motion by Ms. Jardin, a second by Ms. Dewar. All those in favor? Opposed? We are adjourned.